Looks like rain. Well, it was rain. Looks like rain again. I should clarify. It looks like rain again. Yeah, we had some rain last night, so everything's a bit moist. Table's kind of wet. Can't go over there. I was going to film in the voodoo garden because it was supposed to rain, and then I walked in there. I opened up the door to the voodoo garden and go, whoa. It's like walking out into Houston in the summer. It was awful. Good for the plants, bad for Ray. No, I am not going to sweat doing weekend edition. Not going to do it. I'll spend plenty of time indoors during the winter when I have to be inside. Right now, I want to be outside. It's beautiful. It's only 72 degrees out here. It's beautiful. It's shorts weather. Yes, it is. And cats running all over the place. And some cowboy just decided to gun his pickup to show off. Hey, have a nice day at work. I say that semi-sarcastically because here I am at work enjoying my life. Good morning. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Weekend Edition with my lovely co-host, as always, Clover. One of these days, it will be Rascal. More than likely, it'll be during the indoor filming because he can't come back here. So many cats back here, it would just be like living in a blender with cats going all over the place and dog running all over the place. We don't need that kind of chaos right now. So I'm going to just do it right out here by the garden. Hey, look, flowers. Yep, and not only flowers, pumpkins. It turns out this is a pumpkin. It's not only a pumpkin, it's a very prolific pumpkin. Don't know where it came from. I don't recognize it. I've never seen this pumpkin before in my life. But apparently it likes it here. I can't get into my strawberry bed because the pumpkin took over. I can't get over here to get in the garden because the pumpkin took over. The cats can no longer poo in that bed back here because, yes, the pumpkin took over. Yes, the pumpkin is taking care of everything. One of these days, that pumpkin plant's going to be doing weekend edition. So, address your questions accordingly. Okay, Bob, let's get started. Lori, you are first in line. I use compost. Yes, you do. I use compost, blood meal, bone meal, and a little bit of wood ash. I applied blooming liquid fertilizer about a month ago, but this year my corn plants aren't very green. So I'm missing something. Do you know what that could be? Well, Lori, it sounds like you're adding a lot of stuff to your soil. And all of those, wonderful things. But too much of a good thing is usually not a good thing. Corn are very simple plants. Basically, they're like the fat uncle who sits at the table and he just starts eating. He's not really too awful picky what he eats. He just starts eating. And I say that with love for my uncle. He was like that. And anyway, what corn needs is rich, well-drained, deep soil and lots of sun. That's it. Now, as far as getting the rich soil, you're adding the compost, right? Compost is fine. Bagged manure. Oh, if you're making your compost, that's wonderful. You know what you need to do? Dig a bunch of it in. Don't just lay it on top. Dig it in deep, lots of it. There's no such thing as too much compost when you're growing corn. You don't need the blood meal. You don't need the bone meal. The bone meal is going to be for calcium, more than likely. Your soil, if you have good compost in there, it has calcium. So, the bone meal, not necessary. The compost has enough nitrogen, so you don't really need the blood meal. Don't eat my transmitter. You're worse than the goat. You're cuter than the goat. But she's playing with the transmitter, so if I'm cutting in and out, her fault. Send your hate mail to her. So you don't really need the blood meal. As far as the liquid fertilizer, like I said, if you're adding good rich compost, nix that as well. All of those extra things that you're adding may be messing with the balance in the soil. Also, wood ash. Although wood ash is good for adding minerals to your soil, wood ash is alkaline. And that's actually what they used to make lye soap with, ashes. And that stuff will burn your skin off. But wood ashes, I know you say you're adding a little, but the wood ashes may be raising up the pH of your soil so that it can't take in the nutrients that it needs in order to stay healthy. So my advice would be to give it a shot one season, to just don't add anything except a whole boatload of compost. See what that does for you. That's what I add to mine, and you saw how it did. It did really, really well. So I'm hoping that'll work for you. Give it a shot. If that doesn't work, come back to me and we'll figure out something else. But I'm pretty sure that that's going to work out for you, okay? All right, next one is from Your Needsery. Did I do that right? I probably didn't do that right. Anyway, you know who you are. Hey, Ray, I wanted to ask, what type of fertilizer did you put on that peach tree? It was so small. It was small last year. Now it's huge, like your apple tree. Only compost, or what? Mine are still little twigs. I planted last spring. Mine are contender variety here in Minnesota. Minnesota is a tough. It's a tough nut to crack when it comes to growing peach trees. I tried it. Didn't work out for me. I did two different kinds, and one the deer liked, which is, you know, good for the deer, but I didn't like it so much. And another one, I think it was Reliant. Yeah, Reliant peaches. I think that's what it was. I could be wrong. Probably am. So I tried it. The temperature up there is definitely not conducive to growing peaches. So if you can find a variety that grows up there, go for it. If anybody knows a variety that's good for growing up there, let your know that, okay? What I did for mine is I make compost, and I do it pretty good. I gotta tell you, I do good compost, but that's because I use a lot of chicken manure and goat manure and stuff in it, and lately cat manure. So what I did was I just piled it on around there, not touching the tree. Never let your mulch or compost touch the actual trunk. Make a ring around it, nice and thick. Every single spring, add about an inch or 2 inches of rich compost onto that. What it'll do, it filters down. I've shown the apple tree, at least I think I have. It's overloaded. I actually have too many apples this year, and I'm going to be showing that in a future episode. It may sound good, like, hey, you're buried in apples. Well, I'm going to show you the actual downside of being buried in apples, okay? Yeah, I try to preach and practice that moderation and everything, balance and everything. Well, it turns out I had the weird perfect storm when it came to apples this year. No deer. Don't know where they all went. I don't know. They're maybe in a burger in Boise, Idaho, for all I know. There's no deer this year eating my apples. The influx of cats have chased the one squirrel away that I used to have over there. No squirrel to, you know, nibble on the apples. And then I threw all of that grass and leaves that broke down over the winter in a big ring around the tree. Remember that? And I got a morel mushroom from it. Well, that leached down, fertilized the tree. It also kept the soil moist, which helped the tree. So what did the tree do? It goes, hey, look what I can do. And it put out too many apples. And what happened was now the tree is bowed down. Yeah, very dangerous. And I didn't notice it right off the bat. It just kind of happened overnight with all the rain we've been having and the fertilizer. Everything came together. Too many apples. So anyway, back to the peach tree. That thing has grown like crazy. It was just a stick when I got it just a few years ago. If you've been following along, you remember that. Yeah, just a little stick. Well, what happened is I fertilize it. I give it the deep watering, let it dry out, deep watering, let it dry out, just like any other garden plant. And that's what kicked it into gear. The first year, whenever you plant something, is always going to be the year where it's getting its mind right, is what I call it. That means it's getting settled in. That's all that means. It's getting settled in because you plant this thing, and I think mine might have been a little potted one. So it was in its little crappy potting soil that they put in it. It's bark and nose hairs and all kinds of stupid stuff that they use. It's real cheap. So that's not really good stuff. But I don't want to take it all off the roots because I can hurt the roots. So I planted it. I put compost and loosened up the soil around the perimeter. And what that did was the first year, it got settled in and started sending out little roots. The next year, it went nuts and it sent out even more roots. The year after that, which I believe is this year, then it went back crazy. And I also fertilized it and it rained really well. So now I have this perfect combination going. That's what did my peach tree. Also, I made sure after the first year when it started growing wonky branches, I got those out of there. Okay, I don't prune the first year. But as far as helping your tree out, what I would recommend, you don't want to dig it up and start over. What you want to do, lay a layer of compost every single year. That's going to do it for you. Okay? All right, next one. Christine. Good morning, Christine. I keep trying to plant kale, but the bugs, they always get them. Oh, sorry, gotta arrange this microphone. Okay, there we go. I just planted some plants, and they have these tiny green worms that have eaten them down to the ribs. Do you have any suggestions on growing kale? Well, growing kale, just like I mentioned in years, the previous question is rich, well-drained soil. You know, that's the key to everything. Rich, well-drained soil. I don't know any plant that doesn't like that. Okay, I've grown a lot of things from cactus to succulents, tropicals, mundane, everything seems to appreciate well-drained soil, even cactus. Yeah, I grew an orchid enriched, well-drained soil, not just in bark and stuff. And it flowered a few times and grew like crazy, and people told me, you can't do that. On the programs where I was showing them me doing it, I don't get it. So to what you have an issue with, the kale, give it the rich, well-drained soil. That will produce. Remember I showed the program down there where I had this big, honking, stinking kale and we taste-tested it? That was the kale that I saw on the website. Just a common a curly leaf kale or something like that. I don't remember exactly what it's called, but it's the only one that I saw on the website. It's a wonderful, wonderful product, and it's delicious. So what I did was I planted that. I grew it just to see if I could grow it. I wasn't planning on eating it. It turns out I did, and there's no more kale left over. Well, what happens with kale, cabbages, cole crops, broccoli, cauliflower, those are all in the same area. You get these little green worms. Yeah, you've seen those. People know what I'm talking about. We call them cabbage worms, okay? There's a bunch of them in that family, but they're basically, we call them cabbage worms. Little worms that show up, and then they bring their friends. They're caused by a moth. A moth lays its eggs, you little Velcro bugger, you. Now, a moth lays its eggs around there. They hatch, turn into these little tiny green caterpillars, and they show up all of a sudden, and then they start eating holes and eating around the perimeter, and then eventually you got these ribs with the, like you have. Well, it's those caterpillars, okay? They're green, they're gross, they're a pest. What you need to, this is the one way, and I go old-fashioned. I don't go all kinds of fangled stuff about how to deal with it. The one way that I found that works, people can say, sprinkle diatomaceous earth, neem, all this stuff. What I do, I pluck them off. I take the time. There is no no-till gardening here. There is no hands-off gardening here. This is hands-on, in-your-face gardening that I do. It's my joy. It's my love. It's my exercise. So I come out here in the garden, and I look at the plants in the morning because they love it in the cool of the morning, and they don't hide. Once the sun comes up, those worms hide, and they can hide really well because they're the same color as your plant. And you know, when you're like Mr. Magoo like me, it's hard to see those things. So I come out in the morning when they're still chomping down and they're unaware, sipping my coffee, go pluck, 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 feed them to the chickens. If you don't have chickens, stomp on them. I know that's mean, it's insect abuse, but it's either that or you're not going to have any plants. Pluck those buggers off. You can't keep the moths away. So what you do is you have to take care of the children. Pluck them off, throw them over a fence to your neighbor's yard, throw them out somewhere. If you throw them anywhere like 100 feet away, they're never going to find their way back to your plants. They may chomp something else, and that's going to happen, but it's not something that you're doing wrong. These moths are coming in off a breeze. They're coming from everywhere. So no matter what you do, they're still going to come in. So what I do is I just pluck them off. That's my solution. That's my answer. That's how I deal with it. And I've never had a problem. You'll have some chewed up leaves, but at least you'll have leaves. Rinse them off, get all their poo off of there, and you're still going to be able to eat it. It's going to be just fine. I'm covered in cats. They're crawling up on the red shed. Okay, back we go. Ann Crombez. Hi, Ann. That's my mom's name, Ann. Hi, Ray. When is a good time, spring or fall, to plant sunchokes? And by sunchoke, she means Jerusalem artichokes, those big plants that I showed you that are growing and they flower and stuff. Spring. You can plant them in fall. I prefer spring because what will happen is if you plant them in autumn, you want to plant them to where it's so cold they don't start sprouting. Because if they start sprouting, they're going to want to grow, and then it gets cold and it kills the plant. And that's a lot of strain on the bulb to put out all the energy to start a plant that's not going to live. The first frost is going to kill that plant. So you may get a warm part later on in the fall. You never know how weather's going to go. So if you get a warm part, those bulbs are going to think it's spring, and they start germinating. I don't want that to happen. So what I do is I plant them in spring. Overwinter them in a cool, dry place, like in your basement, or buy them in the spring. Plant them down a few inches to where the top of the bulb is a few inches below the soil surface. Give them rich, well-drained soil. They're going to do wonders. Even bad soil, they're going to do wonders, but they do a lot better in rich, well-drained soil. And if you don't harvest them and don't eat them, don't do that. They will spread, they will spread, they will give you all kinds of new plants, and eventually you're going to be buried in those things. So just have patience, plant them in the spring, give them a couple years, and then you're going to be harvesting them like mad, or you're going to have a forest like I do. Okay, you had too much coffee today. I don't think I like you. Okay, next one is from Donna. Hi, Donna. I'm getting a blue-gray mold on trees and bushes. What can I do to get rid of it? Oh, you know, I get that. I get, well, I don't get it, but my plants get it. My lilacs. Remember I did a program when I sit by my lilacs? Well, in midsummer, around midsummer to late summer, they get this whitish haze on top of them. This happened in Minnesota when I lived in Delft, but they still get it here. That is called powdery mildew. Other plants will get it too. Some trees will get it as well. You know what? You don't have to worry about it. You can spray them with any kind of fungicide and that'll get rid of it. But the thing is, the powdery mildew does not really do any kind of harm to the plant. It's just one of those things that happen. It blows in off the breeze. You can get rid of the fungus the next day. It can get reinfected. And the fact that it doesn't actually, it's not like blight, where a blight is a fungus, but blight will decimate a plant. Powdery mildew generally doesn't do that to a healthy growing bush or tree. So my advice is just don't worry about it. Yeah, it's an ugly aspect of what happens during the season, but it's not a game ender for you. It's just one of those things that happen. Like, you know, during the season, my plants may get a little bit of something going on, but I'm not growing them for show. So I really don't worry about it. As far as that fungus goes, I get them on mine. I don't worry about it. The next season, they grow back nice, big, and healthy. They put out the flowers. Everybody's happy. They put in the new growth. And then when they stop growing, they get the fungus for the end of the season. Then the leaves eventually fall off, and the cycle starts all over again. Okay, next one. Hi. I kiss you on the head. Doodah girl. I was waiting for that one. I like that. I actually had a bird named Doodah. Yeah, it was a little pea chick that I hatched. I did a program. I was sitting on the porch back when I lived on the 80 acres, and I had her in my hand, and I was rocking on the porch with little Doodah doing a program. Yep, she was a little pea chick that I hatched and raised for a short time. Anyway, Doodah girl says, I have flowers and stuff on my balcony, and they've been decimated by what appears to be white gnats. You know, little things flying around. If I shake a plant, a million of them fly around, and I believe they laid eggs on the underside of the leaves. Yes, they did. Fly, go away. The flies around here, they bite, so I got to get them off of me. The leaves also become slick. They become slick looking and sticky, kind of like a honeydew type stuff on it. Can you tell me what they are and how to get rid of them? Oh, absolutely. This has happened to me quite a bit. They're called white flies. They're itty bitty white flies. They almost look like little moths if you look up close. If you have a magnifying glass, they look like micro moths. They're white flies. And generally, they don't do anything except for irritate you if it's an outdoor growing plant. If it's an indoor plant, you want to treat it right away. What I would recommend, spraying them with pyrethrin, top and bottom. But you got to make sure you get them all at once, okay? Because what they'll do is they'll fly off the plant the minute you start treating them. So if you're going to treat an indoor plant, take it outside, put it on your picnic table. Do this in the evening when the sun's not on them, because the sun can harm your indoor plants. If it's an indoor plant, okay, I'll get to the outdoor plants. If it's an indoor plant, what you do is you take them outside, get the stuff ready, mist them on the bottom, get those bugs and mist them on the top everywhere. On the bottom and the top, it'll kill the eggs, kill the larvae, kill the adults. Not a problem. Get them back indoors. Do it to every plant that you have to make sure if there's eggs on them that you get them. Now, you grow on a balcony. This is outdoor. If you grow on a regular garden, generally they're not that much of an issue in an in-ground garden because your plant has healthy root systems. They outgrow that kind of stuff. But what happens is that honeydew and stuff will be a food source for fungus. That's the problem. It will attract a fungus, and fungus feeds off of that sugar, and it'll infect your plant. That's why you want to get rid of these white flies. The white flies don't do so much damage, but they invite the fungus, which actually does do the damage. See what I'm telling? Okay, so what we do is out on your balcony, the exact same thing you would do with an indoor plant. When the sun's not on them, get your sprayer, get ready, and spray the underside, the top side with pyrethrin, and the soil surface all the way around. Now, that will kill them instantly, but it will not leave a residual effect. If you want to make sure that you leave a residual effect to harm these critters, what you can do is forego the pyrethrin and use neem, N-E-E-M. Mix it as directed, mist your plants bottom to top, soil and everything. Only do it once. Neem can be a little bit stressful on your plants. It's a natural type of thing. It's made from the neem tree. But when your plants are under attack, they're under stress. So when they're under stress and you treat them, that added little bit of stress of the treatment can also exacerbate the problem. So only do it once. The neem leaves a residual. So when those flies that got missed come back, they're going to land on the neem. They're going to eat the neem. They're going to die. Yes, they are. I wish you the best on your plans, but that's my solution for him, and it's worked every time for me. Next one, Grant. You want to fight me? Is that what you want to do? She's tough, tough kitty. Anyway, Grant. I like the looks of the white and black rooster. Is that a specific breed or a country mix? For those of you who don't know what he's talking about, let's take a little bit of a field trip, shall we? I'm going to show you the mutt or the purebred, whatever it may be. Let's go take a look at it. Ah, nice try. Good hustle. This is a hen. That means it's a female chicken. Right above her, that loudmouth, that's a rooster. That's a male of the species. And then behind him, hidden over there, that's the one he's talking about, the black and white. Okay, I wanted to show you this. Now, this is the mother. And I forgot what she's called. Oh, gosh, I wish I could remember. Those of you who know chickens, let me know. I know her every day of the week, but whenever I'm on the spot, I forget. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and remember it and then post the name right underneath her here, okay? The type of chicken she is. She's a purebred chicken. And the rooster that was... Oh, actually, hold on a second. This one right here, there's the daddy. That's big man on campus. That one right there is an Americana or Araucana. Depends on how you look at him. And he's a beauty. Big, red, colorful tail. And those are what's called Easter egg chickens. You know, the ones that lay the blue and green eggs? Yeah, they're really cool. Well, he's the father, she's the mother. And that one that I showed you back there that was hidden, that's their child. He took the coloring of the mother, but the little tufts around his cheeks, they're over there in the weeds, and there's no way I'm going through there. But the little tufts on his cheek come from his father. Yep. You might call it a mutt. It's just a crossbreed, and they can be any color, any shape, any size whenever you start mixing them like that. Yep. That's a crossbreed. And the questions go. Oh. Oh, gosh. Look at that. Crap. That's pollen. Yeah, there. I have weeds all over the place. Yeah, I'm sure you've noticed them. I was over there filming the rooster. I came back. It looked like I had mustard seed all over me. It was pollen. Yeah, I just stood up against the weeds. Yeah, it's pollen season around here. There's always something that's pollinating around here. Hi. Oh, baby kitties everywhere. Yeah. Okay, anyway, I hope that answers your question. They're fun birds. Yeah, and the eggs are delicious, too. The thing is, the daddy, he's the top rooster. And the way that flocks work is the top rooster gets mating rights, okay? He can mate with all the females, but the other guys, no, you stay away from those females. And his total job is to keep the females happy, fed, and mated so that they can raise baby chicks. And he does not want her to propagate the genetics of a competing male. So what he's been doing all the time behind the scenes is running down those males and keeping them away from the females. He'll chase them, he'll peck them, he'll beat the heck out of them to keep them away from the females. And their job as competing males is to sneak in and try and mate with the females. So we have a lot of drama going on here. Out in the reality show that is Ray's Farm, yes. So every now and then you hear chickens fighting and screaming and stuff. Don't worry, it's just him beating up his sons, basically, yeah? A little bit of hillbilly going on around here. Okay, let's get on to something a little bit more family-friendly. Margie, hi Margie. Hi Ray. I just wondering if you've ever planted tulips or daffodils. I just love to see them bloom in the spring. Such a welcoming sight after a long, cold winter like we sometimes experience here in the Midwest. Yes, I did. I actually grew tulips in the voodoo garden. Yeah, I grew them in the voodoo garden, in pots, and they were blooming and having a good time. I remember tulips when I was a kid, and that's why I grew them in the voodoo garden, because there are certain things that I remember as a child, and I had a childhood that was not very good, okay? So I'll just leave it at that. My childhood sucked, but there were certain little dots of happiness in there, and I took that happiness and I held on to that. And I tried to use that to overshadow the bad things in my life as a child. The smell of tulips, the lady that lived behind us in the apartments that we lived in, she had the cherry tree that I mentioned in my book. My best friend Donnie and I would creep over there and steal cherries off of her tree. Well, I would also notice her tulips that she had growing right in front of her apartment. And it was just so amazing because that's the only tulips I'd ever seen in my life. They were beautiful and they smelled good. Yeah. Imagine that, tulips that actually had a smell. Nowadays, tulips don't have smells, roses don't have smells, nothing has smells, tomatoes don't have flavor. The world has gone black and white as far as I'm concerned. Back then, it was all about flavor and smells and stuff. Now, with all the hybrids and stuff and saving money, all of that's gone down the drain. So I really appreciated the smell, and I would sneak up on my way back from school. I'd have to walk by her apartment, and I knew she wasn't outside during the day. She'd only come out in the morning and evening when it was cooler. So I'd walk up there, I'd go, I'd run. So I love tulips, and I remember seeing daffodils at another apartment. So I always liked those, but one thing I liked them more than anything in the world was hyacinth. I know some people think their smell is too strong. Those are one of the first flowers of spring. I love the smell of those. Purple hyacinth is my absolute favorite. And as I get older, and I will get older, as I get older later on, and possibly after I retire from doing programs, years down the line, I may take some of my garden beds, and I'll still grow vegetables. I'll always grow vegetables. I'll be that guy that you'll find dead in his garden with a garden trowel and a tomato. But what I'm going to do is some of my garden beds, I'm not going to grow yearly things. I'm going to turn into flowers. So I'm going to have tulips and daffodils and hyacinth growing in there. I'm going to have my grapevine. I'm going to have a rose bush. I'm going to have things like that growing where you normally see peppers, tomatoes and stuff. I'll still have the standards, but I want to grow more perennial stuff that comes back every year. And that's definitely going to be on my list. Oh, they're wonderful, wonderful plants. Next one, Dan. Hit in. All right, I'm thinking of changing into raised beds. I have seen soils, compost, and organic fertilizers are on sale now in the stores near me, which is in Zone 3, way up there in Canada. I'm planning on filling the raised beds with those. Good idea. Don't do it. There's a mosquito trying to bite me. I'm delicious. Yes, I am. Actually, my blood is. Okay, should I make the raised beds and fill them now before winter, or should I buy bags and fill them in the spring? Should I add fertilizer before winter? Can I use potting mix too in the raised beds? Okay, that's relatively easy, and this is what I would do if I were you. I would fill my beds in the fall. And yes, you can use potting soil. Don't use too much. It's peat moss. Usually potting soil is nothing more than just peat moss with a little bit of fertilizer sprayed in. That's it. That's it. Maybe some shredded bark. But what it is it's acidic. And that's okay. Use a little bit of that if you want. Just sprinkle it in and mix it in. But mostly, use dirt. Regular dirt. Bag dirt. Dirt that you dig up. That's going to be about maybe about half of what you put into that raised bed. That's the foundation. Okay? And then, aha! Bite my neck, will you? You end up dead. Okay. You use half dirt, and then you use half compost. You got to have a lot of compost in there. You got one chance to do it right. Take that compost, mix it in there. Mix it all in really good. If you want to throw in a little bit of potting soil to lighten it up a little bit, that's okay too. Put in a heavy dusting of that and mix it in. You're going to be just fine. But okay, now I itch. But do it in the autumn. And the reason I say that is because when you add them all together, you never know how strong that compost is, whether you make it or buy it. And if it's fresh and it hasn't broken down all the way and you plant seeds in it, it's going to harm the seeds and the new sprouts. You mix it all up together, let it rest for the winter and mellow a little bit. And in the spring, you're doing just fine. So yeah, do it in the autumn. And if you have any kind of yard like grass clippings, leaves or anything, fill your raised beds and then top it off and lay a deep layer of those leaves and grass on top of that. I've done that. And what will happen is it attracts the worms and the microbes to come up and digest that. And it further fertilizes your soil in the autumn and in early spring. Or when spring comes along and it comes to be planting time, rake off those leaves and grass. Put it in a pile somewhere off to the back of your yard. Let it break down for the rest of the season. Then that coming up autumn, mix that in with your soil, let it rest over the winter. The second year, let me tell you something, you're going to be jumping up and down because you're going to have a garden that grows bonkers. That is the magic, that's the magic bullet that's going to get your garden going so well. I got some great stuff going down there, and that's exactly what I did to my garden. Okay, next one, and by the way, good luck. Next one is from CGD1125. I'll just call you CG, okay? Hi, CG. Hi, Ray. I want to grow some perennial flowers next year from seed and plant in our yard. I'm in Massachusetts. When would you plant them? I have a small greenhouse I start plants in and I use that I use in our kitchen near the sliding doors. My husband bought me a plastic greenhouse I can set up outside and I would like to use it, but can I use that when it's still cold outside around March? I'd plant in the early spring, and that's what those greenhouses are for. What they do is when it's cold outside, they trap the heat of the day into that greenhouse and it raises the temperature. It can be any amount depending on how much sun you have, how late in the season it is. And for instance, in Massachusetts, if your planting date, your last frost date, say is May 15th, okay? I don't know when it is. Let's just say it's May 15th. You can start stuff in your greenhouse a month earlier because it'll even out that temperature to be a little bit higher and you won't have to worry about it so much. So whatever your planting date is outside, I would feel comfortable starting stuff a month earlier, planting it from seed and bulbs and stuff like that, start them indoors, and then when the planting season comes, take them outside, plant them out in your garden. Okay, next one. Woo, look at us go. We got four questions to go, and these are good ones too. All right, get ready. Here we go. All right. Martin. In Sweden or somewhere up there in the Netherlands. Can you explain to us how you deal with the problems and setbacks in your life and you keep going? In one of your programs, you told you have depression. That's true. In one of your programs, you told you have depression. You lost a place to live because it burned to the ground. You've moved because of problems with your neighbors and had family problems with your stepfather. You were neglected as a kid. Well, you're making my life sound good. You were neglected as a kid, and at some point, you were suicidal and ended up in the hospital. And still, you put a smile on your face, jump out of bed in the morning, love and treat your animals as your best friends. Oh, thank you. And have a best friend and start a new business with your seed shop. In some point in time, everybody faces setbacks, problems, losses, and sad moments in their lives, but the difference is how we deal with it and how we move on. I think it would be helpful for a lot of us if you can share some of your knowledge on this topic. Wow. Big question. I can give you an answer to that. All of that is true. I did have a really sucky childhood. I had no control over it. You know, I was just along for the ride. And adults, they set the tone, they set the level for their children. The children are just along for the ride. They're learning by watching you. Whatever you do, they see. You don't think that they're paying attention. They're paying attention. Children are nothing more than a sponge, and you are the source that fills that sponge up. Whatever you do, good or bad, that goes into your child. And then your child takes that information, processes it, and then they make a decision on how they're going to be. Subconscious, conscious, doesn't matter. It has an effect on how they emerge as a young adult. And then they can do what they can to change the bad, to accentuate the good. But you're the one that gives them that. You got to know this. I was raised in a single family home, but then again, fathers came and went. You know, it was like a revolving door. My mother was an alcoholic. She started out when she was young. So my childhood sucked. I can't change that. My mom can't change what she did. Okay, but what I did was I tried to make the very best of a bad situation. I made mistakes, but you know, I was a kid. I was trying to do the very best I could in an imperfect situation. I had problems as an adult. I didn't handle them all the way that I would want to handle them. You know, in hindsight, we're all geniuses in hindsight. But when you're in the middle of that storm, you know, you do the very best you can, and sometimes you make mistakes, and outsiders look at it and they go, oh, you messed that up. Well, you know what? You weren't here. So yeah, I came down with depression, which is a chemical imbalance in your system that you had no control over, okay? People that have depression, you got to know this. It's not your fault, okay? It is something that happens inside your body, and it changes the way that your receptors take the serotonin, the melatonin, the way that you process stuff that comes into you. You're broken. is what you are. And you need to figure out the best way to fix a broken self and to change the way that you do things. And that is so difficult to do when you're the one suffering. It's easier for everybody else sitting around there being armchair psychiatrists. But when you're in the middle of that, let me tell you something. I didn't understand it. I was an armchair psychiatrist, and my mother had depression. When I came down with it, that's when I realized, wow, that's what you went through, Mom? And she says, yeah, that's what I went through, Ray. And so when I went through it, I took the dark route, and I almost ended up dead, and I ended up in a hospital because of my poor choice in the situation. I overdosed. And I took all of that and tried to bring myself out of it. And with the grace of, you could say God, I say with the grace of everything around me and my best friend and the support that I got from him, I brought myself out of that and I found a better day. That's what I did. But for my advice for everybody is to do the very best that you can and be okay with not doing perfect, okay? You're not a perfect creature. You're not in a perfect situation. Do the very best you can moment to moment. You don't know what's coming on tomorrow. None of us do, okay? Tomorrow we could all be gone, okay? All we have is right now. And I mentioned in a previous program, we have what's behind us as our teacher, okay? And we take that information today and we do the very best to make the very best decision for tomorrow, okay? That's how I do it, day to day. I have bad days, I have good days. For my depression, I work on it every single day. I take medication for it. I do the best things that I can do to bring my spirits up. You know, I'm not howdy-doody all the time. I'm smiling here on the programs, but there are days when I sit outside and I just look up at the sky, look up at the trees, and Rascal will come and sit on my lap, Clover comes over, and just the purring helps me along. Just little tiny things, you know? So, yeah, Clover's a big part of my life. Rascal's a big part of my life. Mike, the plants, the weeds, every little thing around here is my support system, and I use it, and I'm not ashamed to do that, okay? Don't be ashamed to ask for help, to look for help, to voice your concerns. Anybody that is going to try and shame you or tell you what you should do, that person is not going to help you, and that person needs to be set aside while you get a little bit selfish and you take care of yourself. And I've said it before, I'll keep saying it. You can't take on the world. You can't heal the world if you can't heal yourself, okay? You are the most important thing. Without you, everything else around you isn't going to matter. Take care of yourself, and when you do that, things will be a little bit better. Don't expect miracles, but do a little bit to help yourself out. That's how I did it. And there are going to be bad times in my future, but you know what? With the tools that I've developed, the way that I figure out how to do things, I'm confident that I'm going to be okay. You know, I'm going to have bad days. I'm going to have good days. But all in all, it's a heck of a journey. And I just love it. I wouldn't have it any other way. Okay, let's get on to Veronica. Hi, Ray. Oh, by the way, hi, Veronica. Hi, Ray. A couple of years ago, you were selling indoor compost. I was wondering if you're going to do that again. Oh, no. No. I did it 2 years in a row. And I loved it. People loved it. They appreciated it. And I appreciate that you do appreciate the effort that went into it and the product. It's a wonderful thing. But it's so much work. It's so much effort to turn that compost and to keep doing it, to take care of it, to make sure it's just right. Because I'm not going to sell second best. Okay? I might use second best, but I wouldn't sell second best. That's just not my business way. I sell the very best I can or I don't sell it at all. So with the compost, I knew that I couldn't continue doing that. So I discontinued it. I'm sorry for the folks that really did enjoy that. I would recommend that you try to make your own compost. You can do the exact same thing, small amounts, small steps. And if you can't, buy the bagged manure. That's the next best thing. If I ever stop making compost, that's the thing I'm going to be using is bagged manure. That's the closest thing to good compost that you can find. All right, next one, looking for the simple life. You got to love the names. Looking for the simple life. Ray, I love your programs. Oh, thank you. What video editing software do you use? Oh, that's easy. It comes with Windows. It's called Movie Maker. Yeah, it comes with your computer. Very basic. My programs are very basic. I don't have fancy cameras. I don't have fancy editing. I don't have fancy anything because that's not the core of what I do here. I just hang out with you and talk to you. You don't need fancy intros. You don't need a big shiny thumbnail picture to draw you in to click on the video. I figure people that are going to tune in, are they going to try it out? They're going to see me. They're either going to like me or dislike me. I can't change how they're going to feel. But the ones that are going to dislike me, they're going to go on and find something that they like, and I wish them well. The ones that like the content, they enjoy my company. They're going to stick around. And that's what I go for. So some programs may go for that fancy stuff. I just don't. Mine's very simple. I'm a very amateur filmographer, video editor, but I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that, and so are my friends. Okay, anyway, my advice is start out simple. If you're going to be doing programs, start out simple. Simple camera, simple editing, and then work your way up. It's a progress. It's a work in progress. Next one. Oh, last one. You are the last one. T.L. Belknap. Hi, Ray. Or, hey, Ray. What are your top 10 favorite books? Ooh. Well, I don't have a top 10 because I very rarely read books anymore. Now that I have a computer, I can read things on a computer. There are no bookstores around here, so it's hard for me to actually get to a used bookstore. I know. It's a thing that's kind of going away. Bookstores, online bookstores, yes. But regular brick-and-mortar bookstores are kind of going away. The used bookstores, thing of the past. They can't make money anymore because people don't want to read offline. They want to read online. And since I'm kind of remote out here, I'm one of those people that find it hard to find those bookstores. So what I do? I read online. Yeah, I do. I still read every single day. I'm a bookworm. And that's probably part of the reason my eyesight is getting kind of poor, because I'm always reading. I love reading. When I'm bored, I get on the computer and I'll look at stuff. And I'll watch some videos, but I generally read stuff. Articles, news articles, gardening articles, things like that. I read constantly. But to answer your question, yes, I have two. I have two favorites, and my favorites used to change depending on what I was reading at the time. You know, one time there was a whole series of sci-fi books. I would have said, oh, those are my favorite. And then I read something else. Ooh, that's my favorite. Then I got into the Carla Emery book, and that was my favorite. So my favorites change. But when I was in, seventh grade, I just got into junior high. We had elementary school, junior high, senior high. That's how it worked there. I don't know what they call them nowadays. But anyway, I was in seventh grade, junior high. And we had a reading class. It was an actual science fiction reading class. And I loved science fiction. I used to go to the library and read all kinds of books when I was in grade school. But they actually gave us books to read. You go to this table and you'd pick a book. Well, I picked a book. And it just happened to be Martian Chronicles by Ray Bradbury. Yes, Martian Chronicles is a classic from way, way back in the day. And it's a very simple book. But what it is it has stories in there of generally a post-apocalyptic planet where civilization is kind of desperate in a way. I found that fascinating. And what's really weird is it's kind of mirrored today. The world has gotten to be a really crazy 1984 dystopian type of place in certain countries. In our country, it's gotten strange. And I tend to back away from it because it's freaking me out. It really is. The inhumanity of people to other people, the way that the planet is being treated as a trash bin. And that's our joke, Mike and I. The world is your dumpster. It shouldn't be like that. People should not treat people poorly. I believe in treating people courteously. Now, people confuse the word respect with courtesy. I treat everybody courteously, politely, right off the bat. Courtesy should be expected and the norm. Respect is earned, okay? Respect is when somebody does something by their actions and the way that they are that earn your admiration and respect, a high way of thinking of them. Whereas courtesy can be extended to anybody right off the bat until they give you a reason otherwise. So when I talk to you, we're friendly, we're getting along real fine. If somebody comes to my comment section or talks to me in person and treats me poorly just for being the way that I am and being a regular person, then they've taken away that. They no longer deserve my courtesy and they have not earned my respect. So some folks, I'm getting to a point here. Some folks tell me, they said, Ray, you're kind of mean sometimes. And other people say I'm kind of nice. And there's a saying, they said, I'm both. I'm nice and I can be mean. I treat people accordingly. All right? We start out on a good level playing field where we're treating each other nice. if you don't give me a reason to treat you poorly, I will never treat you poorly. If you give me a reason, you're going to get exactly what you asked for. So if you ask for politeness and respect and courtesy, that's what you get from me. If you ask for something a little bit more negative, that might be something that you get from me. I'll either block you or tell you exactly what I think of you. That's how I am. Now, getting back to this book, The Martian Chronicles, it was a fascinating book about how people got to a point of treating themselves and everything else around them with in a negative manner, and they suffered the consequences. So that book really hit me, and it stayed with me all my life. There's an actual short story in there called There Will Come Soft Rains. Oh, I read that so many times in my life. It's about a house, an automated house. And you know, that actually has come to fruition. This is back in the 50s or 60s when the story was written, and now houses can become automated. Yeah, all the things that Siri and Alexa and automated stuff your phone can do and your house can do things all by itself, it has come to fruition. This was science fiction back in the day. Well, anyway, the people are dead. A bomb blew up and it left an impression, a shadow of the people on the side of the house. In the middle of playing, the boy and girl were playing ball and on the swings and the couple were having a picnic or something. And it's really kind of sad. They're dead, but the house doesn't know they're dead. And the house continues on as it's supposed to do. It makes breakfast, dinner, cleans up, does things. And I'm giving away the plot of the story, but it's very important. Then something happens. There's a little fire in the house. And the house tries to do what it can do to take care of itself, to preserve the people that it believes are alive. And it tries to save everything. And in its panic, it can't do all of that. And the house slowly dies. And the reason that the house slowly died is because the people are already dead. And the people could have saved the house. But the people, in their arrogance and their negativity, already destroyed themselves. And so the house was the last to go. The person, the thing, the victim in this was actually not even a human. It was so beautiful. And there was a second one by William Slater. It's called House of Stairs. Oh, it's crazy. It's an old book, too. And that book was something else. And it goes on the same lines. It's weird how I like the things that go along the same lines like that. It's about these teenagers that were put into this room. They wake up. And have you ever seen that painting where the stairs go all different directions? It's a classic painting. They're in that painting. They're in that environment. Stairs are going all different directions. As far as the eye can see, stairs, stairs. There's no entrance, no exit, no nothing. Stairs everywhere. Little platforms between the stairs. And they're waking up and they find themselves, somebody's way up there, somebody's way down there. They see each other. They come together. What are we doing here? We don't know why we're here. There's a little machine there. And what happens is when they behave a certain way, it deals out little food, a little bit of food, just enough to keep them alive, but not enough to keep them filled up. And they're like, oh, we have to do something. We have to tap on the floor or something like that twice. And it gives us food. And then after a while, it doesn't do that. You have to do something else. And they have to figure out what that something else is. And the way that their minds work is they become negative and they start turning on each other. And what they become because of what they assume is expected of them in their reality, it's not pretty. It's really disturbing what will come out in human beings when all barriers are taken off and they go by what they assume society expects of them. And it's really a teaching moment. Although it's a simple story, I love that story. So those are my two favorites. And my way of thinking in this world is you can make things a lot better just by doing those little things. Little tiny things. And it goes with those books. Little tiny things that you can do. You can't do it all. Nobody can do it all. None of us can do it all. But what we can do is our own little tiny bit. And that's what I do here. Just my little bit. Okay? I can't change the world. But what I can do is maybe make somebody a little bit happier, maybe make somebody's day. They're going to pay it forward. And maybe they're going to do something for somebody. And it's been proven. It's happened here. So I'm very happy with what I do. It's not a lot, but it's the best that I can do in the situation that I'm in. And I'm content with that. And if everybody would do that, I think the things around us would change. And we can do it. We can do it. Not one of us, but all of us. We can do that. So yeah, there's my big speech for the day. It rounds up weekend edition. I hope you did enjoy yourself. I hope you enjoyed yourself. If you have any questions at all, life, love, liberty, like I said, anything, if you want to know the answer, whether it's gardening, not gardening, pets, not pets, whatever it is, post it in the comment section below. I will add it to Weekend Edition. We'll talk again. Yes, we will. We'll talk again here on Weekend Edition. Thanks, everybody. I appreciate it. Have a great week. I'm going to have a great week. Still want to fight?